oral history interview conducted for the Witness to War Serving the Nation project at Nauset Regional High School on Cape Cod, Massachusetts. For the sake of this interview, please state your full name and the community in which now you reside.
Richard John Terry. I live in Stoughton, Massachusetts.
Thank you. So, where did you grow up?
Stoughton, Massachusetts.
And so you've always lived in Stoughton?
Most of my life. Younger years, I was born in Maine and moved to Connecticut and then the city of Boston and then most of the time in Stoughton.
Okay. Can you summarize your childhood life?
Adventurous. I spent a lot of time near the water down in Long Island Sound in Connecticut. And when I moved to Stoughton, I met some crazy kids and we built houseboats and I had a canvas-covered kayak and I trapped muskrats and went hunting but didn't get anything. But I liked the outdoors.
When you were a kid, what did you want to be when you grew up?
A forest ranger.
What is the first childhood memory that you have?
Going to a park in Portland, Maine with an uncle, where I was born in Portland, and going to this park. It's still there.
Okay. What kind of education do you have?
I have a bachelor's degree in science with a major in marine botany from UMass Amherst.
So what led you to join the military?
Fear of being drafted during 1968 when they were instituted the draft. And I decided to volunteer rather than get drafted and try to plan my own destiny, but it didn't work out. The Army has its own ideas about where they assign you.
Okay. So how did your family feel when you were going to serve in the military?
Mixed reactions. I think they were concerned about the legitimacy of the Vietnam War. But my mother and father and all my relatives had all served in World War II. And they believed that you should serve your country.
What branch of the military did you choose?
U.S. Army.
Did you ever see combat and did you go overseas?
No to both questions.
Okay. So, if you had to change anything that you did in the war, what would it be?
I don't think I'd change anything because when I volunteered, I wanted to be a helicopter pilot on a medevac. My eyesight wasn't good enough to do that, which in hindsight probably was a good thing. Helicopter pilots didn't have a long life. So I was selected by the Army to be a medic, which is probably worse if you get assigned to a war zone like Vietnam.
What type of food did you eat?
Whatever they served us. basic training, for the most part, most military branches, Navy, Army, Air Force, you're basically trained to take orders and execute them and eat whatever they put in front of you because you're hungry. You've been working so hard that when you go to the mess hall, the term for a cafeteria in the Army, it was basic food. It had a lot of protein, a lot of carbohydrates to keep you going. Basically, it was fueling you up in the morning and in the evening. I actually gained weight in basic.
Okay. So what do you think of when you hear the word Vietnam?
Being a medic stateside, my job was to, I spent a lot of time in the operating room working with orthopedic surgeons, and I think of people who had amputees, who were amputees. My first duty assignment was Valley Forge, Pennsylvania, which was an Army hospital, and having worked in a civilian hospital in Boston, I was somewhat prepared, but I wasn't prepared to see guys who had lost their limbs and had given up the will to live, and they basically, I saw one patient, young guy, just died. Shouldn't have died, he just didn't choose to live. So those are the things that stand out in my mind. I think probably my I was married at the time, and my wife was with me at Valley Forge. And I was on duty that day, and she came into the hospital, and we went down to the commissary where you have lunch. And there was a patient there who, a soldier who'd lost his arm. And he met his wife and his newborn for the first time.
So, what was day-to-day life like as a medic?
As a medic, my job, I was assigned to Valley Forge for a while, and then I was assigned to a Army hospital in Virginia, at Fort Lee, Virginia, Kenner Army Hospital. And it was like a 9-to-5 job for the most part, except you were treating patients who had been wounded in a war zone. You were treating patients who were dependents in retired Army personnel or any military personnel who might be near the Army post. So it was a regular clinic morning. There was always surgery. There was rounds to make throughout the in the hospital for the patients that our doctors were working on. And my job was to assist them. My primary job was to put casts on people's broken legs and arms. And I learned I probably put more casts, plaster of Paris casts, on people than most orthopedic surgeons do today.
Wow.
It was like a day-to-day thing.
Okay. So, what was training like?
Well, I guess there's two kinds of training. Basic training, where you learn how to become a soldier. It consists of being physically fit, understanding the military way. When someone gives you an order, you're supposed to do it. You answer very, yes sir, no sir, yes ma'am, no ma'am. You learn how to march. You learn how to, you learn how to take care of yourself and also take care of the equipment that's assigned to you, whether it be an M16 or a gas mask, because the little things really matter when things get rough. And so those are the kinds of things that they taught you. Later on, when you became being trained as a medic, you were trained how to save someone's life, standard first aid, and then advanced procedures. Today, a combat medic in civilian life has the equivalency of a licensed practical nurse, an LPN. You have to insert, inject things into people, close up bad wounds, things like that. So pretty intense. And I think that training, I know the training that I had in the Army has saved my life on one occasion when I got injured badly in a punctured lung, and I knew exactly what to do. I instantly became a medic in my mind. I didn't panic, although I was bleeding. I had a classic sucking chest wound as a civilian, and it was the day after my 29th birthday. And instead of panicking, I backed away. I stayed calm, and I tried to close the wound with a plastic bag, which they had taught us many years earlier as a soldier. So that's the kind of training that I was given. And to this day, I think about, not all the time, but occasionally when somebody gets injured, that training comes right back. And I continue to get refresher courses. I just recently took a CPR AED. Course. You know what AED means? Automatic External Defibrillator.
Mm-hmm.
I got certified on that in November, and it was really a great course. It was a 3-hour course. The CPR was pretty basic, but it's always good to refresh. And then I'd never used an external defibrillator before. I feel very comfortable doing that, and it goes along with my training as a medic.
Okay. If you could go back in time, would you change anything about your military experience?
I would. I would have stayed in college and then joined, and would have been an officer rather than enlisted. I think, not that there's any cachet to being an officer, but money's better, the benefits are better. Probably the tour of duty might have been different. I probably, in hindsight, probably should have joined the Navy instead of the Army, because I love the water. That before I was in service and to this day.
Okay. What is your happiest memory from the war?
Getting discharged. in the Army, as you get closer to your discharge date, it's called getting short. Not physically short, but short in time. And you'd see many cartoons where you say, you know, I'm really short. And you'd see this pair of feet and a helmet and maybe hands. And that was indicative of, I'm almost out of the service.
Okay, so what was the most heroic or kind act that you witnessed during the war?
Probably the doctor that I worked with. He was a orthopedic surgeon, had the highest credentials as a civilian, got drafted, and his name was Dr. Paul Largamasino, big guy, 6'4", talented surgeon. And working with him in the OR, he was never gave up. He insisted that we will save this person's leg or arm or whatever it had to be. And I saw him work almost 48 hours, nonstop, never taking a break. Not like pulling someone away from a landmine or something like that, but in my experience, he stands out. And a funny thing, 20 years after I got out of the Army, I was flying from East Coast to West Coast in a crowded plane, and the person sitting next to me started talking to me after 3.5 hours of flight. We're heading to San Francisco. And he asked me if I was traveling on business or pleasure. I said business. I was going to Los Angeles. And I asked him the same question. He was dropping his daughter off in Boston to go to college and heading home to Sacramento. I said, I served with a guy named Dr. Paul Argamasino who came from Sacramento. And the gentleman said to me, I'm his attorney. Here's my business card. So we exchanged business cards, and about a week later, we called him Dr. Paul. Dr. Paul called me up and asked me how I was. I hadn't talked to him in 20 years.
What did you feel like after you were discharged?
A little displaced. when I got discharged, I was accepted at UMass Amherst to resume college, and the GI Bill, and I was married with two children, and I didn't feel fit in. Now, it was a while. I was actually being polite when I opened the door for a woman, and she yelled at me. This is 1972, 70, somewhere in that range, and so I learned that you had to back off instead of doing, you know, the things that I was taught to do. Things were changing.
So, what event impacted you most?
Being assigned to train and coordinate 60 conscientious objectors down in Fort Sam Houston, which is a Army post in San Antonio where they train you to be medics. These conscientious objectors refused to bear weapons, and I was put in charge of all of them, get them up in the morning, get them to class, and seeing this civil disobedience every day up close, getting actually to know these people and why they refused to bear arms. They would serve, but not with a weapon. I think that's probably my answer.
Who is the most memorable person that you met during your service?
Dr. Paul Largamasino, surgeon.
Did you see him every day during your...
When I was assigned to Fort Lee, Virginia, I saw him every day for about a year and a half. And sometimes we'd be on call together, rushing at midnight, trying to fix somebody's leg or whatever it was. Broken.
What was the last time you were in touch with someone from the war?
Actually, I'm in touch with a couple of my Army buddies. Ben Bailey and I met each other in basic training down in Fort Jackson, South Carolina, kind of protecting each other in a brawl that broke out. And he was from White Plains, and I was from Boston. And I talked to him Christmas Eve.
Would you say that your best, do you still, who was your best friend from the war?
I really didn't have a best friend. You get moved around so much that you don't really make friends because you may not see them again for whatever reason. But I think the buddies that I was, Ben, we ended up not only knowing each other in basic training, but a year and a half later, we were both assigned to the same post, Army post. And there was four or five others. And because of Ben, he's kept us all together. We live all over the country, and we still communicate. So, yeah, that'd be the... You don't have best friends, but you have friendships for a long time.
Okay. What is your most difficult memory from the war?
Probably, and without a doubt, being assigned to Valley Forge Army Hospital. It was a 1,500-bed amputee hospital. Working there every day was really an eye-opener.
Can you walk us through that hospital?
Yeah, I can. It's no longer a hospital. And it is in Valley Forge. And it was a wooden hospital, World War I vintage. And now here it is, 1969-70. It was eerie walking through the halls of long corridors with barrack-style rooms off to the side. No private rooms. It was I think it was a three-story building. And everybody there was an amputee, either arm or leg or more. And my wife was living with me. We lived in a town called Pottstown, PA, where they make Mrs. Smith's pies. Best smelling town I've ever been in, right near the Army post. And she came to pick me up, and I was working on the second floor. For some reason, she went up to get me. And there was a fellow who had lost an arm and a leg, and he was on a gurney. And he could move himself. He was trying to get through a set of double doors. And my wife opened the door for him, and he started screaming at her, "I don't need your help," and many other bad things, you know, bad words. It was a really tough place because people either got out of there or they didn't, and you spent a lot of time in the operating room.
What is the most memorable patient that you met?
I don't have any. I don't think I have a memorable patient.
Did you ever interact with them and, like, speak with them?
You know, you just jog my memory. At Valley Forge, I went down to the court where they play handball, and I'd never played that. And I had some time off, and this fellow said, "Come on in, I'll show you how to play." And you wear leather gloves. Have you guys ever played handball? It's a little ball about that big, and you hit it with your hand against the wall, and it can hit any of the walls. And the rules are pretty simple: keep the ball from bouncing twice on the floor. Kind of like tennis, but it's a fast-moving game. And I didn't have leather gloves, but I said, "I'm tough, I can handle it." My hands were almost swollen by the time I got done playing my first time, and this guy beat me soundly. So I said, "I'll be back." And this went on for weeks, and I finally beat him. And he always wore sweatpants, and he said, "Not bad for beating a gimp." He lost his leg below his knee, and this was his way of getting fit again, ambulatory. And I'm like, that's probably the memory I have. That's a good memory. Even though I beat him, he was, you know, that wasn't the point at all. The point was he was teaching me, despite the fact he was badly injured. I don't know his name either. Never did. At least maybe first name.
Did you go to college before or after you were
both
drafted?
I got accepted to Boston University and immediately got drafted onto the BU crew team, A-Road Racing. And I got so wrapped up in that, my grades failed. And by the end of the second year, my sophomore year, they asked me to take a little time off. And I was really embarrassed. I was the first one in my family on both sides to go to college. And I'd been kicked out of school. And it was so embarrassing that I couldn't tell my mother until the next September when I was supposed to be going back to school. I finally had to tell her. And so I had some jobs for a while, and I ended up working at Peter Beck Brigham Hospital, which is now known as Brigham and Women's. And that's when things got hot with Vietnam, and I ended up volunteering. Afterwards, and during the Army, when I was stationed in Virginia, I took a lot of courses at night. The Army would pay for the entire course, and I had to buy the books. So I took courses that would apply to wherever I wanted to go later. UMass Amherst was the most obvious choice. It was free to a Massachusetts resident who was a veteran. And I got a $385 stipend from Uncle Sam to support a wife and two children. Big bucks. And so I went back to school and got a bachelor's degree in the sciences.
Have you ever shared your experiences with other people?
Not too much. Well, mostly the funny things. I don't normally talk about stuff at Valley Forge. I think most people are like that.
What's your funniest memory from the war?
All my crazy friends down in Fort Lee, Virginia, Ben Bailey, and Marty Maloney from Brooklyn, and a couple of guys from Champigny from New Orleans, and they call it the Terry Day in reference to my wife. Her nickname was Terry, although my last name was Terry. And we just had a baby, and they had this big wiffle ball tournament. We had trophies for a second place. We played the national anthem by, who's the guy who did Purple Haze? Anyhow. And to this day, this mention of the wiffle ball tournament for Terry Day, meeting my wife, because now she was no longer pregnant. And it was right outside the Army post at Fort Lee, Virginia, on a person's land who didn't like Northerners and didn't particularly care for us being in the Army, but he was willing to rent his property to us.
How did people react when you told them that you served for Vietnam?
Pretty neutral for the most part, except a little negatively when I went back to school at UMass Amherst. So I didn't talk about it. I used to wear my field jacket. It said U.S. Army in my name. And I stopped wearing that because I got a little bit of pushback. And I stopped opening doors for people. And I stopped saying yes, sir, and no, ma'am, that sort of thing.
If your grandchild came to you saying they were considering joining the military, what advice would you give them?
Finish college first. I have a granddaughter who's she's going to start second semester senior year. If she said to me she wanted to join the military, I'd say, good, go in as an officer and try to pick and choose as best you can your direction and be safe.
How does the war still affect you today?
Not too much. I don't have really bad, I don't have nightmares like some guys, some of my friends who served in combat positions. I think about some of the people that I worked with and worked on, and I wonder how they are doing, you know. So that's my thoughts.
Do you think that joining the military has affected your view on the world?
Repeat the question.
Do you think that your experience in the military has affected your view on the world?
Absolutely. One, I really think that everybody should serve their country in some capacity, whether it be in a combat role or not, but I think we all owe a little bit to our country. I use Israel as an example. In Israel, they don't discriminate. Men and women fight for their country. They have no choice. I think we have no choice. We need to give back to our country starting at an early age rather than later when you may have more money. But I think that experience of understanding chain of command, there's someone in charge, whether you're in school or in a job or in the military, accountability up and down the chain, you're accountable up and you're accountable to the person below you, you're responsible for the people below you. Sebastian's father, who's a skipper, a licensed captain, he has extraordinary responsibilities to his passengers and his vessel and to other people. That's like the military. You have responsibilities. He accepted it. And I think that our country would be probably less emotional in times like this if we all had a more similar experience. Not to say we should be homogeneous in anything, but because this country isn't that. But being in a military situation or serving your country and having that kind of chain of order, I think is important.
How would you suggest to a young person to get involved with the country, to serve it?
One, really learn some history. And don't read the stuff on social media. You can't trust it. And it looks real and truthful, but sometimes it isn't. So I think, first and foremost, really understand the history of our country, not just from the books, because sometimes schools tend to, a little bit of bias, and they don't cover all the things. Read more about Abe Lincoln and other people who've written about him. And then you can be a little more qualified in making choices about how to help your country. Is it, I'm going to join the military, or is it, I'm going to finish college and get a very good job and be productive and give back, either through community volunteerism, that's a good thing, or even a monetary donation if you have that kind of opportunity. But I think involvement at any level, in all levels, is important. People who just sit back and say, I'm going to get a job and go buy a nice house and a nice boat and not care about anyone else, that's not a good thing. Or worse, stick your head in the sand and not care, and only care about the Patriots. That's a good thing, but they're not the only thing going. And you know from your own experiences, there's some people who have no clue what's going on. They never look at the news. They don't, or the news they see is so local. You ever watch BBC? The same night you watch BBC and you watch Channel 7 news, is this the same planet? Not CNN, but BBC News or NPR. When I'm on the road a lot for my family's business. I'm on the sales side, and I listen to the radio. I listen to NPR, I listen to WBZ, and then I listen to The River, 92.5, because it has a whole mix of music. But in the meantime, I'm hearing a very leftist type of newscast from NPR, and I'm seeing a more middle of the road from WBZ 1030. And it gives me a lot of time to think and agree or disagree. I don't have to even talk to anybody. And then I can come home and then read, really get into it. And Facebook and those other things, they're nice. They're really nice to be able to communicate with your families across the country. But there's so much bad, inaccurate information that I think it's a detriment. And you shouldn't get your news that way.
Overall, are you happy how you served in the military?
I'm happy. I'm happy to say that's a volunteer.
Can you describe some of your friends that were in the war with you?
One couple. Guy was in the Army, his wife was with him. And they worked in special services. I can't think of his wife's name. And his job was to entertain the officers at the officers' club. He was a singer and a guitar player, really good, very talented. His wife was a singer, so she sang and he played the guitar. That's what they did every day. They went to the officers' club. A couple other guys were in special services, and it was their job at the Army post to help guys recuperate. And they passed out basketballs and gym shoes. The other guys I worked with, the medics, basically were just waiting to get a chute to fall and get orders to Vietnam. And their education ranged from high school graduates, but most of them were college graduates or had some college. One was a programmer. He worked for the Edison Company in New York. York City, so his job is to work the night shift in the data center. And he didn't even wear a uniform, because nobody cared. But he was a very bright guy. So, real strong mix of people, mostly with good educational backgrounds. Our friend Champini was a real, got from the Bayous, and didn't have much education, but we loved him all because he was so funny. And he always seemed to cut to the chase when there was an argument or discussion about the politics of the war. Despite his lack of education, he understood some of the things we didn't.
Okay. So, it seems like you enjoyed your, well, you liked your, the military. You liked the military.
I liked it. And I didn't like it. It's a love-hate relationship, I think. Mainly because, one, there's an anxiety element. You don't know when or where you might be stationed. I was one oldest of Vietnam 4 times. It gets to be a little stressful, you know. And you get ready to go, you get your shots, you requalify with the M16, and you get your bags packed, and then my orders would be changed again. That was the hate part. The part that I liked was I really took a lot of pride in being a good medic and treating people and working with them, and you know, they're hurt, and you got to make it better. So I enjoyed that part.
Okay. Thank you for your time in the military, and thank you for doing this interview.
Thank you so much.
Good questions.